Hello and welcome to Catholic Answers Live. I am Cy Kellett, your host. Thanks so much for being here with us on this Thursday afternoon. Maybe it's a Thursday evening where you are, maybe even a Friday morning. I'm a little distracted because Darren's whole family is here and all the kids are in the studio. I'm trying to do a good job. So you guys keep an eye on me. I'm trying to do a good job. We'll try to do a good show with you here. Second hour, we got Jimmy Akin. We'll do open forum. And you, of course, are welcome to call for that. First hour, we welcome a special guest. And it's always so nice when we get special guests from the Midwest and from Catholic education and from, I don't know, what else can I name?
Chiefs Kingdom.
Oh, that's not so nice. No.
I mean, I know you're San Diego fans out here. Chiefs Kingdom.
Oh, no. No one told me he was going to do that. Can we rescind the invitation or is it too late? Is it too late to rescind the invitation?
Harrison Butker is our commencement speaker. I'll just say that. There's a connection there. Yeah. Great Catholic guy.
Well, we're gonna talk with Joe Wirtz is our guest. He's the Dean of Students and Executive Director of the Gregorian Fellows Leadership Program at Benedictine College in Atchison, Kansas, and therefore a Chiefs fan. He's been in Catholic education for a long time, and among the things that are part of his purview as the Dean of Students are helping students develop not just as scholars, but that's an important part, of course, of what they do, but of the fullness of the human development. And one thing I suppose you might notice about young people these days is that that's a particular struggle. Is that right, Joe?
It is a big struggle. I remember in 2012, there was a lot of conversation about Title IX, but our attorney at the time said, well, wait till the mental health illnesses hit. Because they were seeing this uptick. And so we've seen a lot of things like a mental health day, right? We have a 30% increase in our mental health needs on campus. So there's a growing, and a lot of this is anxiety driven. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of anxiety, a lot of data suggesting that social media, smartphones, right, all that stuff. So we see this on our campus too.
And if you'd like to call and get in on the conversation at any time with Joe Wirtz, Dean of Students at Benedictine College, you are welcome to call 888-318-7884. So what we're going to apply, I suppose you'd say, a little bit of classical wisdom to this problem, not just clinical wisdom, but classical wisdom to this problem. So how long have people been thinking about ailments of the soul, so to speak?
Yeah, for centuries, right? This goes way back to it's the human condition, right? Mm-hmm. There were goddesses and gods of misery, right?
Yeah.
So the humans have always dealt with this condition of sorrow and sadness in the soul. And so there's a lot of wisdom to be gained by some of the ancients and Aristotle in particular. And I can reference some of those things in our talk today.
Remedies for sadness of the soul today, 888-318-7884. If I may, I would like to know a little bit about Benedictine College, though, because I have not been there. I hope that I will get to visit there because everything I hear is just exemplary. It sounds like a truly Christian community and a place of real scholarship.
It's a great place, and it's in Atchison, Kansas, which is flyover country for you guys out here, Si, I guess. But it's a school founded in 1858 by the Benedictine monks who came originally from Germany. So we have a German Benedictine heritage. It was founded as a men's school, St. Benedict's, and there was a women's school, the Mount. They merged in the 70s and became Benedictine College then. But we really trace our history back to 1858. We're about 2,300 students. We're largely residential. We're a Catholic, Benedictine, liberal arts residential college.
Well, let me ask you this then, because it does seem you get to a certain age and you can see some trends maybe, and it does seem that there's every generation has its problems, every generation has its what it revolts against about the previous generation, but it does seem that a pattern has been interrupted in a certain sense by the advent of the smartphone.
Yeah.
That it really is a machine for creating misery for young people.
It is, and I'll throw out a few stats just to kind of contextualize this. So in 1976, the year I was born, the amount of time students would go out with friends held steady for 30 years. And then in 2011, 2010, it just nosedived. So they saw this alienation of students hanging out with their friends. So it's gotten to the point now where some people have called it, a nuclear bomb went off on teenage life.
Yeah.
It's causing all kinds of mental health. So basically, I would say the data suggests that there are more hours a child devotes to social media. The more hours they devote to social media, the higher their risk for mental health problems. And we're seeing that even in our institution today.
Well, when you apply kind of that this classical lens of maladies of the soul, of sadness in the soul, would you say that there's any important difference? Because I do. I actually think young people don't think there's an important difference. But what would you say? Is there an important difference between hanging out with your friends physically and hanging out with your friends electronically?
No question.
And what's the difference, though?
Yeah. It's a great question. I think we saw this during COVID, right? I think there is something in the human person. They desire face-to-face contact, physical contact. We're physical beings, and I think we need that physical association with one another. I mean, look, men in particular, right? We need risk, and we get that with games, right? Playing with other men, doing some competition, right?
Yeah.
And I don't think that can be replaced by a video game competition. I think there's something in our physical nature that needs that kind of physical tension with one another, right? Women, right? Their brains actually get a dopamine burst with conversation. And I think a lot of that is facial. Women, you know, they saw this with infants, for example.
Oh.
Infant females looked at the face. Mm-hmm. Infant males followed objects, right? I think this speaks to something in our biology, generally speaking.
Right. So a lot of your thinking about sadness of the soul and the remedies for it, because we spoke just briefly before the program about this, comes from Joseph Pieper?
Yes. So I was doing research on men's formation, and
okay.
I came across the idea of Christian Man that was written in, I think, 49. And Pieper has this little section where he talks about our embodied natures. And he mm-hmm. says, you know, there's been periods in our history, intellectual history, where people dismiss the body. And I think we're in that period now, this
right.
alienation from the body. He says there's a lot of good things about the body, and he talks about these remedies of sadness in a physical way. And I was interested in this because we do a lot of human formation. And I think that's probably the number one topic that I see as dean of students, the need for human formation, not to overly spiritualize or undervalue the body. And so a lot of my thinking came along after reading that, of thinking about, all right, what are some of these natural remedies? And I'll share another a side story. So in 2018, I broke my leg, and it was a traumatic break. So it was a very bad injury. And there was a point I had 6 different surgeries. We actually entertained cutting off my leg. I mean, it was one of those moments
I'm
in
sorry
time.
To hear that.
Yeah,
holy smokes.
Well, my wife was my nurse at home. So I was 9 months out of work, right? So, but there came a point after one of the surgeries where I had breakthrough pain, where the pain was so great,
mm-hmm.
The medicine wasn't getting it down. So I had this experience of physical pain that was so traumatic. I was like, give me whatever it takes to get rid of this pain. I can now appreciate the amount of emotional pain some people have, right? I don't have that kind of emotional pain, but I think some people in our culture have great emotional pain, that they'll do whatever it takes to eradicate this emotional pain, right? I think in our culture, we see a lot of emotional pain, and this goes back to our topic of human formation. How do we deal with that? Right? How do we deal with the emotional pain, the anxieties that young people have, in large part caused by our social media culture, our cancel culture? There's a lot of fear in Gen Z, right?
Yeah.
A lot of fear. And these are our students going to be coming to college. So my interest in this human formation side is, how do we help relieve some of that, right? How do we help students through this pain, through this anxiety, through this stress, when the traditional institutions, marriage and family, right, our mediating institutions, even the church, have lost trust, right? Lost trust for students. So it takes a lot of accompaniment, walking with our students, understanding their pain, listening, and then offering some very practical solutions to that.
I'm interested that it was your own pain that gave you a kind of compassion mm-hmm. towards the invisible pain that's the pain of the heart, the pain of the emotions. Because one thing that bothers me, and I guess it kind of started bothering me when my own children reached late adolescence, early adulthood, is the way people my age, and I'm 60 now, people my age can be dismissive of their pain, kind mm-hmm. of almost in a humiliating way. Like, mm-hmm. toughen up, you little, Gen, I don't know, I can never remember which generation is which, but Gen Z or whatever they are. You know, get your act together, you snowflakes. Right. And they didn't cause this problem. They're not the ones who broke up the families mm-hmm. and destroyed the communities and invented these technologies that are so isolating.
Right. That's right.
They didn't do it.
That's
compassion
right.
is the right response to them.
Yeah, and I sympathize with the response too, because I've found myself doing it, but it doesn't work. Jonathan Haidt wrote a lot about this recently in The Anxious Generation. He says a lot of it is to be blamed on the parenting styles, right? Because I'm a Gen Xer, right? And we were very skeptical of a latchkey kind of parenting. And I think there was an overprotection that resulted. And so kids were protected from growing in resilience, right? Mm-hmm. And this constant supervision, this constant worry, the constant media worry about the world created this anxiety in our kids, right? And so I think he makes a good argument there. A lot could be blamed on us as parents by how we parented and what was in the culture. Like, this is how you ought to parent in this overly protective way. We talked about helicopter parents or whatever it may be. Creating or moving any obstacles for their children actually created a worse phenomenon, right?
Yep.
Kevin Majors has this company called Optimum Work, and they talk about this. If we don't face our fear and approach the fear, then it won't get better. Actually, when we retreat from the fear, our amygdala signals to us, okay, you were right in your assessment that that fear is bad and I should double down. But that makes it harder then to overcome fear. This is why ancient wisdom is approach your fear, right? Combat your fear with courage. Now we've taken the approach of, okay, it's too dangerous, which confirms a feeling that then doubles down on the difficulty to overcome it. So you create phobias, right? You create this sheltered mentality. Then it's harder for them to confront fear. Right?
Yeah.
And I think we've done that as parents, unfortunately.
888-318-7884 is the number. From Benedictine College, the Dean of Students from Benedictine College in Kansas is our guest, Joe Wirtz. And we're talking about remedies for sadness of the soul. It is all around us. You can see, I mean, sometimes I don't know if you have this experience. You go to the supermarket and you can see on people's faces, they look just horrified and sad and broken. And maybe I wasn't paying attention when I was young, but it seems worse now than ever. This sense of the kind of the walking wounded everywhere.
I would agree. I mean, the statistics are bearing this out. 145% increase in depression for teenage girls, 161% for teenage boys. 1 in 4 college students experience some kind of mental health disorder today. So the stats are reflecting, right? Gen Z appears to be the most, you know, mentally ill cohort that we've seen,
right? Yeah.
So there's a lot of this. And again, going back to these larger societal issues, right? There's a lot of breakdowns in institutions that normally would hold up kind of a cultural continuity and stability. Those, you know, have crumbled. And so where do people turn? Where do young people turn? And I think that's part of the issue today is who do they go to, right? And they go to experts, so you see a lot more counselor relationships, but really we need to foster authentic friendships, right? And the smartphones are an obstacle to that, mm-hmm. right? And so how do you not dismiss all of technology, but how do you regulate it such that they can have authentic in-person relationships and not just online relationships?
When we come back, I want to ask about specifically how do you handle that at Benedictine College and what you're learning from mm-hmm. the practical side of dealing with young people who probably have spent a huge percentage of their formative years on these devices. But we got to take a break, so we'll do that when we come back. Joe Wirtz is our guest. The number is 888-318-7884. Maybe you're a parent and you'd like to talk about what you see with your own kids and the maladies of the soul, particularly sadness of the soul of young people in the world today. Maybe you are a young person who has developed habits that you think have brought on this sadness in the soul. Whatever your situation is, if you'd like to talk about it, you are welcome to call 888-318-7884.
We're here for you. Call now. Catholic Answers Live.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects home buyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Magnificat. Published monthly, Magnificat features texts of daily Mass, prayers, articles, meditations, art commentaries, and more, in step with the liturgical rhythm of the Church, on the web at magnificat.com.
Each weekday, we'll dive into the timeless teachings of our Catholic faith, drawing upon the wisdom of the ages to navigate the challenges of today. Together, we'll seek truth, find inspiration, and forge a deeper connection with God. I'm Deacon Harold Burke Sivers, and I invite you to join me for Beacon of Truth, tomorrow at 4 p.m. Eastern on EWTN Radio.
Thank you.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Joe Wirtz is our guest this hour. Your call's welcome if you want to talk about remedies for sadness of the soul. 888-318-7884, 888-318-7884. Joe is the Dean of Students at Benedictine College in Kansas. 2,300 students there. You're also a husband and father of six yourself. And Megan, thank you for coming in and being in the studio here with us. But I wanted to get back to circle back to something you said, because look, you're a Benedictine college formed by monks, and you seem to be saying that this spiritual malady should not be dealt with only spiritually. Mm-hmm. Which I'm getting a little disconnect here. I thought religious people are supposed to think it's all about the spirit.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, great question. And before I answer, I do want to give a brief shout out to Dr. Wirtz, my brother, who's an avid listener, and he's very jealous that I'm in here today. He would much prefer himself being in here. Well,
we would too, but we couldn't get him. No, yeah, I'm just kidding, Joe.
Right, delivering babies somewhere in Nebraska. He's a family practice doctor.
Oh, yeah. God bless him.
All right. When people tell me, hey, you're Dr. Wirtz, right? I was like, well, I'm not that doctor. So,
Okay. How are you feeling? Yeah, how exactly, far apart are the contractions?
Exactly.
Yeah. Okay.
But to your question, I mean, we are a combined, soul and body. And I think, again, different periods of our history, people overemphasize one or the other. And it's natural when people are trying to think through mental health issues, right? Is this a spiritual problem? And there's nothing wrong with thinking that way, but a lot of times they're not thinking first on the natural level. And I think that's, as Catholics, we always want to discern that.
Like, okay,
what's happening on the natural level? Am I really in touch with what's going on? Am I in touch with all the small decisions that I've made over the course of my life that may lead me to this point? I think we want to discern that first before jumping right into the spiritual realm, because a lot of times it could be resolved from a natural perspective, not discounting the importance of the spiritual nature of things, and that plays a role. For sure.
But I do feel like maybe that is there's a weird correlation between this machine culture we live in and over-spiritualizing things, because you're almost living in the world of the mind, mm-hmm. and you're not living in the world of the body.
Yes. Well, and particularly today, we had a priest on our campus, Father Michael Baggett, who's just did a dissertation on transhumanism and talking about this, phenomena that we're seeing with AI and this, out-of-body experience, that the mind is really the center of who we are. And there's dangers there, right? Because we don't believe that, right? We are fully human, and that includes our divine nature, our soul. So I think for the modern person to understand this distinction that, we don't want to throw aside the body at all, right? We are embodied persons. JP2 wrote extensively on this, and I think we're still going to be studying his work there in Theology of the Body. It's very important to understand the human person. When we reject those elements of the human person, then we come up with these pathologies, mm-hmm. right? Whether it's this, overly spiritualized, or, hey, there's no spiritual nature, do with the body whatever you want, right? These are pathologies that err, right, from who we truly are. So I think if we truly understand who we are, created in the image and likeness of God, and how that plays out in life, then we can lessen some of these pathologies, right? Certainly we have the fall, and we're humans with a condition that needs redemption, right? We need a savior. And I think that's another point lost, is that we can't do this on our own. There's no utopian society here.
Right, right. 888-318-7884 is the number. 888-318-7884. So, what's life like at Benedictine College? I mean, do you have any restrictions on the machines? The phones, or if not restrictions, do you have any helps to the students in that regard?
Yeah, great question. We are obviously exhort and encourage our students to have face-to-face interactions, take the earbuds out when you're walking around campus, greet people, right? Because that's a Benedictine charism of hospitality. We want to live that out and live that out well. We also have students who participate in a movement called Humanality, which is this, trying to spread this movement of disconnecting from devices. It could be as simple as when you come to the dining hall, put your phone in a basket, don't touch it, right? Turn off phones in the classroom, have face-to-face conversation, lessening the dependency on our technology, right? And I think we've seen a great deal of enthusiasm behind these sorts of things. We have groups of students who live in community where no Wi-Fi.
Oh.
Yeah. They just want to say, look, we want to disconnect. If we need to do anything, we'll go into a public space and use it. We don't want it in our residence hall, right? And where
wow.
we live. Right. So I think they're seeing this and deciding it.
Okay, so the you said there is excitement about it, though. Like, they don't, the students don't experience this as onerous. They experience it as liberating, or what? How do they experience it?
For sure. I think they've seen some of the negative ramifications, right? Because social media is so tied to the cancel culture that if you do something, you know, there are stories that, you know, we all know. Student says something on a video for 4 seconds and it ruins their life.
Yeah.
And they grew up in this culture, right? This cancel culture of social media. And so I think they've seen that and they're like, I don't want that. I don't want that for me. I don't want that for my friends. So let's see the dangers that are in it, not reject it outright, but we need to regulate it. And we need to create habits where we can regulate it ourselves. Because we want our students to do that. We want to empower them to be self-sufficient, right? They're maturing adults. So we want them to grow and have the freedom to regulate their own lives, right?
Gabrielle is in Ohio. Thank you for the call, Gabrielle. Go ahead with your question for Dr. Joe Wirtz. Oh, Gabrielle, having trouble hearing you.
Yeah, I hear you better now. Yes?
No, it's I tell you what I'm going to do. I'm sorry to do this to you, but I'm going to put you on hold and have Edgar work with you on that because it's just too distant. We can't quite make out what you're saying, Gabrielle. Well, we'll get you on. Just hang on. Edgar's going to straighten out the line for you. The number is 888-318-7884. If you'd like to ask any questions about remedies for sadness of the soul, you are welcome to call 888-318-7884. 888-318-7884. So how much does the kind of, you know, the Catholic teaching, I suppose, that we took from the pagan philosophers about virtue virtues as being habits and all of that, how much of that just comes into this idea of human development?
Mm-hmm. I think a vast amount of it. I think the ancients were onto something there, right? And Aquinas saw that, right? And reading Aristotle and coming back to this idea of habits and virtue and formation. And there's a current book that I recommend to folks all the time called Atomic Habits, James Clear. I think it's repackaged Aristotle, but he makes a great point. He has a whole lot of practical advice on how do you build good habits and break bad habits, right? And so much of it, I mean, we're creatures that imitate. Right, we imitate those around us, and we develop habits by these choices, and those habits form our character, right? And it can deform us as well. I mean, we can form bad habits and create vice that now is like a second nature, right? So there's so much wisdom in the ancients there, and the medievals brought this out, and throughout our intellectual history, we see this coming back to, I mean, virtue is making a comeback in elite institutions all over the world. Oxford, for example, right? They're going back to this connection of virtue and happiness, right?
Yes.
Guys like Arthur Brooks, right? I mean, talking about happiness. Well, that's connected to our virtuous living, right? And it's not oppressive, right? It's not rule-based, right? It's simply in connection with who we are in our nature, so.
It's one of those things that was really stupidly abandoned. I mean, stupidly abandoned in the sense that after the Second World War, this growing idea that liberation meant just have fun and do what you want, and without really thinking about it, we gave up what had made society happy and functioning for, you know, I don't know, hundreds of years. Yes. This idea of virtue and of the teaching of virtue, we just stopped thinking that way all of a sudden.
Absolutely. And I think there are some elements in the progressive education movement, you know, they eradicated metaphysics and studying who the human person was. And, you know, so I think there are a lot of areas, sexual revolution, yeah, you know, this liberation, this disconnect between the body and the soul and the emotions. And so there's, I think going back to the remedies, it's studying the ancients and going back to this understanding of virtue leads to happiness and true freedom, freedom for excellence instead of freedom from authority, freedom from right, oppressive regime, whatever that may be.
I think Gabrielle will work now. Gabrielle, we got you. Do we have you there on the phone?
Yes, I'm here.
Oh, beautiful. We can hear you very well now. Go ahead.
Great. Okay, I'm a medical doctor, and I want to share a little, the importance of hope and faith. And, of course, and that has to do with also with family and loved ones. There's a wonderful book by Viktor Frankl. He's a psychiatrist.
Yes.
He was very young when he was in the concentration camp because he's Jewish. And he noticed all these wonderfully strong men and strapping women who came to the concentration camp, and they all died. But he would see some frail little old ladies that hardly could move, and they'd survive. So he wrote this book called In Search of Meaning. And he went and met all these people who survived the concentration camp. He asked, what was it? There was a common denominator. And it was hope. They kept us thinking, oh, my loved husband or my loved daughter is probably out there waiting for me.
So, Gabrielle, I have to make that wait for just 2 minutes. We finally got you on, and now the commercial break started. So I'm delighted to leave it with Viktor Frankl and hope, but we'll come back and let you continue your point right after this on Catholic Answers Live. Why We're Catholic is the one book you can hand to anyone to invite them into or back to the Catholic faith. With more than 400,000 copies sold, Trent Horn's book has had a number one ranking on Amazon.com for 5 years running. Now available in softcover, bulk cases, ebook, and on Audible. Find out what the excitement is all about. Order your copies of Why We're Catholic at shop.catholic.com or at a good Catholic bookstore. Visit whyweirecatholic.com.
If you're not a Bible scholar, the full message of how the Sunday Mass readings fit together can be tough to comprehend. Apologist Carlo Broussard is here to help. Join Carlo every Friday for the Sunday Catholic Word Podcast. In each episode, he unpacks the scripture readings for that Sunday and brings them all together so you can better understand and defend the faith. Visit SundayCatholicWord.com to subscribe. That's SundayCatholicWord.com.
Is Orthodoxy an alternative to the Catholic Church? In a time of uncertainty for many Catholics, Orthodoxy can look like greener pastures. Answering Orthodoxy, the new book from Catholic Answers Press, explains why Catholics who are thinking of leaving need to think twice. There are important reasons to remain in the Catholic Church and convincing answers to Orthodox claims. Order your copy of Answering Orthodoxy today at shop.catholic.com or ask for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Our Lord needs articulate defenders of the truth to spread the joy of the Catholic faith. Catholic Answers Monthly Giving Club, Society 315, helps you fulfill the call in 1 Peter 3:15 to always be prepared to make a defense for the hope that is in you. For as little as $10 a month, you'll help Catholics grow in faith, bring lapsed Catholics home, and lead non-Catholics to the truth. Go to CASociety315.com and join today.
Well, that's one way to get rid of sadness in the soul. Play a little groovy music.
There you go.
Thank you, Darren. 888-318-7884 is the number. At a terrible moment, I had to interrupt Gabrielle in Ohio, who was talking about Viktor Frankl and the idea that hope and faith matter in the wellness and even the survivability of the person. I'm sorry I had to interrupt you, Gabrielle. Go ahead with your thought.
That's okay. So I don't know where I dropped off, but He followed the people who had left the concentration camp and survived, even though they were frail and old, and he found there was a common denominator, and that was hope. They kept on thinking, oh, my daughter, my husband must be out there, and the hope kept them healthy and alive. Now, I'm a doctor in medicine, and everybody knows that if you don't have good health, you spend a lot of money, and you don't feel well, and then you end up maybe even losing your mind, your job. And if you don't have money, then you end up, you know, being depressed. So it's a circle.
Yeah.
So health, of course, your human health is extremely important. And now we have discovered that humans are really designed to eat mainly plant-based food, not animal or processed food. So that's really important. And then the next thing is there has to be a little bit of balance. You have to have some exercise. If you are in a wheelchair and you can't get out of your wheelchair, turn on some nice music that reminds you of when you were a teenager and wiggle in the wheelchair just for a good 10 minutes every day. If you can walk a little bit, then walk. If you dance, or if you can get a dog to go out there to make yourself change habits. You cannot be all day watching TV. So a little bit of exercise and music are very therapeutic.
Let me get Joe to respond to that. That does seem to have resonances of what you're saying, Dr. Wirtz.
Well, I love Viktor Frankl's work, and I truly recommend that and this idea of hope. And hope is not the same as optimism, right? In that book, because you have in hope, you have to confront the brutal reality, right? So they didn't look around their surroundings in the concentration camps and go, oh, this is great. In fact, the people who thought, oh, I'm going to be saved tomorrow, actually then were, you know, realized they weren't. And so they died earlier. It's the people that understood the difficulty they were in, but persevered in hope because of a loved one, right? They thought about their wife or their kids and being reunited. That kept them alive, right? So I fully agree. I mean, the virtue of hope is critical to our mental health, to our survival as a species.
It's so, Gabrielle, thank you so much for your patience and for the wonderful points that you made. But what you just said about realizing the situation you're in is important, that I don't think our society has yet realized the situation we're in vis-a-vis what's happening to children and then what the consequence is in the life of teenagers and then the life of young adults. I still think we're in denial about how much damage we're doing to them.
I would agree with that. And I think in a highly materialistic world that we're in, right, we have running water, we have medicines, right? We can live this way for a while without fully realizing what's going on around us, right? We have students who go over the world in mission trips, and they often come back more moved by people's faith in third world countries, people who don't, you know, they live in shacks. They don't know where their next meal is coming from, but they have great faith. And they've said such, right? They say, well, I woke up this morning, I didn't know where I was going to get food, but here you came. God brought you to me, and now I have food to eat, right? I have cleaner water.
Yeah.
And it's a lesson for our kids to see this perspective that these individuals, these communities who don't have everything provided for them have deep faith, right?
888-318-7884 is the number. Teresa couldn't stay on the line in Cincinnati, Ohio. She was listening on Sacred Heart Radio, and she said, could you explain what you mean by sadness of the soul? We've been talking a bit about remedies for sadness of the soul. So what are you talking about when you say sadness of the soul?
Yeah, so when I'm referencing it, so there are a couple of resources, but I think basically there are four types of the sadness of the soul that are addressed in Pieper's work. And he talks about anxiety, right? So when people are weighed down by the future, that's what anxiety is. He talks about torpor, when people don't want to get out of bed, they don't want to move, right? Their body is sluggish, right? That's a form of this. Pity can be compassionate, but it can also be condescending, so causing sorrow for people's state in life. And then he talks about envy, which is the worst type of sorrow, being envious is having sorrow over someone else's benefit, right? You see someone who's doing well in life and you envy them so much so that it causes you sorrow. You've compared, this is the social media phenomenon, you've compared their life to yours and their life looks awesome on social media. So right. I envy it and it creates sorrow in my soul, right? So those are kind of the four ones that he mentions. And then Aquinas has these remedies to combat those.
Okay, so give me just a real quick rundown again of Aquinas' remedies then sadnesses of the soul.
Aquinas is great because one of the things he talks about is just simple pleasure, right? So when you're sad, enjoying a good movie, right? Eating a bowl of ice cream.
He did not say enjoy a good movie.
Well,
there's
a medieval kind of movie.
Oh, yeah, right. Enjoy a good passion play.
I'm sure his was beer. Good beer, right?
Yeah.
And that's true, right? We all have a good beer. You know, that helps. He actually talks about weeping. So I'm not a crier, but some people, they're like, I just need a good cry and I'm good. Right?
It's okay if you are, Joe.
Yeah.
I just want you to know if you need to, it's okay.
Just not in my nature. I'm a positive guy.
All right.
Another thing that always strikes people is he says a warm bath, right? A warm bath. This is Aquinas, right? Talking about this, you know, because the body is part of who we are, right? And we can take care of the body in ways that improves it. I can tell you that from being up, you know, when I broke my leg, to take a shower was arduous, right?
Yeah.
And looking outside, watching people drive cars, right? Because I couldn't drive. Those were simple pleasures that I longed for that I couldn't have. Once I got them back, there was this is awesome, right? Sorrow goes away. So those are some of the remedies he mentions.
Again, 888-318-7884, the number 888-318-7884. If you've got questions about these maladies of the soul that are not new but are magnified by the way that we live, certainly by the abstraction of our lives that... You know, I'll give you an example of this. I give this example sometimes, but somebody did a study of I think it might have been Harvard, but it was some university where they have astronomy students. Mm-hmm. And the study was very simple. Just ask the astronomy students, how many of you have gone out to a place that's dark so that you could see the Milky Way with your naked eye? These are astronomy students. Fewer than half had.
Wow.
Because they experience science through instruments. They don't modern science is done through a computer, through the various machines that are the spectrometers and the spaceships and all of that stuff. So they don't actually experience nature, even though their entire life is devoted to studying nature. They're not experiencing it. So that's what I mean when I say this abstraction of modern life, that there's very little contact with that, with the stuff that we're supposed to be living in.
Yeah, isn't that sad? And that goes back to Jonathan Haidt in The Anxious Generation. He mentions this. One of the things that it could be a remedy now is unstructured play for kids, right? Instead of us creating this atmosphere and making them play in a certain way, he's saying, let them go outside, right? Climb walls. I mean, as a kid in Phoenix, we used to climb walls. We'd catch lizards, right? We'd build, blocks. We'd throw rocks at each other. I mean, ride bikes and, around the neighborhood, unstructured free play.
Right.
So experiencing the world, right, around us, that's another remedy, right? That contact with nature. And you hear that a lot. Obviously California is an outdoor place, Colorado. A lot of people experience God through those moments, right? Seeing the grandeur of God and in nature and just having that breathing clean air, right? I mean, these are good things for us. So the more we limit that exposure, it's going to cause sadness.
Yeah, and we'd limit the exposure because, maybe we could say something about the person who actually feels trapped by the technology then. Mm. I mean, there are a whole host of addictions that you could get. I mean, you could, I was going to say you could get addicted to a particular social media thing, like, say, Instagram or something. You could be an Instagram. But it's not just that you're getting addicted. It's that the people who make those things intend to make you addicted. It's almost like they're doing a war on your soul, that they're warring against your soul. So I think many people feel very ashamed at how much television they watch or at how much time they spend on TikTok or the more extreme ends on things like gambling or pornography that are not just indirectly damaging but are directly damaging the soul. So can you talk to me a little bit about the person who it doesn't just want better habits or experiencing sadness, but actually feels trapped and can't get out of it, feels that they can't get out of it.
Yeah, that's a great question. And I think studies have shown addiction itself is 60% genetic. So, I think for us to think about that for our own kids, like, okay, is my addiction being passed on, right? And I think there are ways around any addiction, right? But it's often not it cannot be isolated to the individual person, right? There's a need for help. There's a need for intervention with addiction, right? And from my experience of just talking to people who've been addicts of something, right? You always hear that, I had to hit rock bottom. Like I had to hit a point where I didn't want this pain in my life anymore. But unless they're willing to cooperate, the addiction is going to continue, right? Because it is somewhat dependent on the person's willingness, their desire to change that behavior. Can be done, right? There are 12-step programs. There are ways in which people can fight against the addictions. The phone is going to be, it's an addiction, right? And to your point, these companies spend billions of dollars to keep you on it, right? Yep. This is a business proposition. So they know what dopamine releases, the likes, all those things. They've run experiments. They know this, right? And they've put a lot of money into it. So that's what I tell my students all the time. Look, there's billions of dollars spent to keep that phone in your pocket, right? And keep you attached to it. Mm-hmm. And we have to be aware of that, right?
Yeah, you have to be aware that I guess we've always said you're fighting against powers and principalities, but some of those powers and principalities have offices in San Francisco.
That's right. And they're coming to a neighborhood near you.
Yeah. Again, 888-318-7884. We got to take a quick break. I might, when we come back, ask you a bit. Your job is dean of students at Benedictine College in Kansas, and you've got 2,300 students on campus at any given time. Who do you worry about? Who do you say that's concerning me? Because I know many parents are not sure when to worry and when to go. Well, you know, because there is the tried and true parental technique of they'll grow out of it, let it go, that's right. And that's not wrong. Most times that's right.
That's right.
But I think there's very high anxiety about. Is this that or is this not that? So maybe we could talk when we come back about which student you worry about. Dr. Joe Wirtz is our guest. He's the Dean of Students at Benedictine College out here to give some talks in San Diego. We're delighted to have him and his wife Megan here in the offices with us today. If you have questions about remedies for sadness of the soul, maybe about in your own raising of your children, maybe in your own life, you are welcome to call 888-318-7884.
Hello, this is Archbishop Salvatore Cordiglione of San Francisco. Keep your dial tuned to Catholic Answers Live.
In Morse code, the sequence SOS is a distress call. It's been said that it stands for Save Our Souls. Well, right now our world is in big trouble, and we're putting out an SOS call for help. Will you answer that call? St. Paul Street Evangelization, a Catholic nonprofit, has hundreds of teams who share the good news with souls who don't know Jesus. Catholic Answers is supported in part by St. Paul Street Evangelization. Visit streetevangelization.com to get involved.
The EWTN home video highlight for April is Hope to Die with Dr. Scott Hahn and Rob Corzine. Dr. Scott Hahn and Rob Corzine explore Catholic teaching on death and the resurrection of the body, helping us to look forward with hope to eternal life with God. Order your DVD set at EWTNRC.com 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, or call 1-800-854-6316.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Oh, what is happening to our souls? It's a tough time to have a soul. I mean, there were times when it was tougher to have a disease, or it was tougher to have all other kinds of conditions. But to have a soul, this is a pretty tough time to have a soul. Joe Wirtz is our guest, the Dean of Students and the Executive Director of the Gregorian Fellows Leadership Program at Benedictine College in Atchison, Kansas. So I asked you before we went to the break, who's the student that you worry about, or what's the situation where you, as the Dean of Students, go, we need to be concerned?
Yeah. Well, and I do want to give you a shout out, Cy, because your questions are great. And, you know, I have a high verbal wife, I have six kids, and my job is mostly listening. So this is a rare opportunity for me to talk about these things.
And you get to talk for once.
Get to talk.
You have a light where you
put
don't.
A mic in front of my face, too. Well, it's a great question. So as a Dean of Students, we have 2,300 students. They're all under my care to some degree, right? Yeah. And I tell them that. I said, I'm your dean, right? So I care about all of them. I think the ones that worry me the most are the ones that don't know how to seek help, right?
Okay.
Because there's a learning posture with our students, right? And, you know, there are some, you know, we have a bell curve of students who come to our campus, right? They're in different developmental stages. Some have good habits, some have bad habits, right? And so I worry about all of them in different ways, because we have very high achieving students that have a lot of stress and anxiety, right? And they need a certain kind of attention. We have the students who don't know how to ask for help. They're hard to recognize sometimes, right? And that's the ones I probably worried about the most, because we hire very well. I have a phenomenal staff, and we hire for mission. People who believe in walking with students, who put their lifeblood into these students and reflect that and model that. Because to us, that's the essence of education. It's not just a transmission of knowledge and wisdom. It's really a human enterprise. It's connecting with people. It's sharing life with one another. So I make a point, and our staff hire very well, so we're modeling these behaviors. But if someone doesn't rise up, someone doesn't know how to ask for help, it's hard to provide for them.
Right.
So those are the ones I think I probably worry about the most, is just, you know, because I hate to be surprised. And sometimes a name comes across your desk and I was like, I had no idea they were struggling. Right.
Yeah.
And those are the ones that are probably the one I'm most concerned with. So I would say to parents, keep those lines of communication open. Like,
right.
I'd rather know of something that I can deal with. Right.
It's interesting hearing you talk about Benedictine College, though, because all of this formation that you talk about, that you're so intentional about, if I send them off to a secular school, that's happening, but it's happening in an undirected, random kind of, you really don't know what you're going to get.
And
I say secular school, but I'm sure that there are religious schools that have the same problem, where there's this, I think sometimes actually parents are shocked at the formation that their student got that first year they went away to university.
Unfortunately, that's true. It's an expensive mistake to make these days. So I always explain it this way, right? The true purpose of the university is pursue truth, and the truth is one, right? In today's university, truth is fragmented and disconnected, and it leaves students with this cognitive dissonance. They don't know truth. They don't think you can even come to know it. So they're either skeptics, right, or they're relativists. They do a lot of emotional reasoning because there's no such thing as truth. So that's, you know, the principal goal there is to pursue truth and show its unity. Outside the classroom, which is my domain, it's, all right, what is that truth? You know the truth. Benedict the 16th said, you know the truth so you can know the good and then live that way. So we're trying to help them connect the truth that they're learning in the classroom with the truth outside the classroom and connect those things. So there's recognition of this is one, this makes sense, this is integrated, my life can be integrated. And there's a goal, right? I have a telos, an end to my life, to be happy, to be one with God. So I think when we can make those connections and help students make those connections, and it's not perfect, right? In our world, it's very messy, right? Living this way, living the moral life is messy for college-age students. But we show them there's a way to do it, right? And we provide enough support and challenge to get them there. So it's a beautiful thing at the end, but I think today it's just this vast sea of ambiguity for a lot of college students. They don't know how to live, they don't know how to think, and they're confused, and then other pathologies develop.
888-318-7884 is the number. We're going to Dallas, Fort Worth, Texas. Gabrielle listening on the Guadalupe Radio Network. Strangely, our second Gabrielle of the day. Wow. Well, we're glad you're here, Gabrielle. Go ahead with your question. No? Did I scare Gabrielle off? I know what it is. Gabrielle, you pushed.
No, I had you on mute.
I knew it. I knew you'd done it. All right, Gabrielle, we're glad you're here. Go ahead with your question.
Thank you. My question is something that you had asked about, or you had mentioned the humanality. And I went and took a look and saw that it was in that area of WCC where one of my children had gone. And I just wanted to know a little bit about resources, if you had any other resources, because I have six children. My youngest is elementary, middle school, and I always wonder what John Senior would do with the TikTok generation.
Oh, Gabrielle, thank you.
Wow, that's a great question.
Yeah.
Love John Senior. You know, in terms of practical resource, I mean, their website is pretty good, and we've been working with them for only a couple months. I have a couple students that have started the club, and my role is to really support this initiative. So I don't have any, off the top of my head, any resources other than that I direct you to their website and just to see how they encourage. I mean, it can take various approaches, right? So we've done gab phones with our kids, right, to keep them off of the smartphone data. It can be, all right, for students who say, I'm going to give up social media for a week, for a month, for Lent, there are scholarships. So you incentivize behavior like that because you want students to try it, right? And so Humanality has developed ways to do that. Speakers, they provide speakers on campus to give talks on, you know, some of the dangers of social media and technology, right? So they have produced a lot of things that I think are good for us to learn about, right? How the brain functions, you know, how the rewiring of the brain functions in relation to some of this technology. It's good for us to know that, right? So those are some of the things I would draw your attention to. But again, that website's pretty good.
Okay, Gabrielle?
Thank you. Yeah.
Yeah, thanks for your question.
Yeah, thanks for bringing up John Senior, and congratulations on all the kids. The number here is 888-318-7884. It's funny when she says the name John Senior, and then I think about what you're doing at Benedictine. There and there's many other examples we could give. It does seem that there have been people who have begun to have the insight that the Catholic University and the Catholic education in general needs to be fitted to this age, there are particular challenges, and there's more and more that are doing that. Mm-hmm. There, it's not a hopeless, it's all ruined. There's people who are in acts of recovery, recovering the Catholic thing and making it work in this circumstance.
Absolutely, and we tell our students, look, there's no victim, and we don't make others into villains, and we're not helpless, right? We can do something. Interestingly, John Senior's project was 45 minutes away from our campus, right, at the University of Kansas. So our students actually took a senior seminar on him last year and so developed some of those techniques. Like we talked about earlier, they would go out and watch the stars, right? They'd play music together, right? They did things, and it's and I've seen this movement grow. I've seen this movement grow in the classical education movement, right? It's just replicating all over the country. And people want this kind of human interaction in their education. They want to explore nature. You've got the whole Catechesis of the Good Shepherd and the Montessori methods that are multiplying all over the country. So I think these educational theories and practices are being reformed, right? It's going to mm-hmm. take a while because, again, our educational system has roots 100 years ago, right? And we're still seeing the logical conclusion of what those theories articulated. So I think it will take time, but I think there are elements in our culture right now that are growing and they're moving and people are seeing this and they're reacting to it. Obviously, we don't overreact in bad ways, but in real authentic ways, I think that we're seeing this.
Yeah, yeah. And I imagine you probably do talk about this at a college, that you're kind of a force multiplier in a way. I mean, you're this little community in a certain sense, in a small place in the middle of the country, but they go out from where you are, and that's they right. start these families and communities, and that it's like the world is starting over every time one of them leaves
yeah,
you.
That's awesome. Yeah, we're in the heart of the country, right? The heartland of America. And our commitment as a college is to transform culture in America. And people think, oh gosh, come on, you're 2,300 students in Atchison, Kansas. Like, Are you serious? Yes.
Yeah, right? You are serious. I love that about you. Yeah,
this
right.
is how the early church did it, right? And I think there is something to be said about the moment the church is in right now is to be much more apostolic, right? It's not a Christian culture that we're really growing up in anymore. You have to be intentionally Catholic in everything you do. And we're seeing that. We challenge our students to go out, right? Not be afraid, right? Go out into your communities and form community, right? Create the things that you've seen here. Right? That's what the Benedictines did, right? To transform Western civilization, right? They went out, they formed monasteries, right? They had learning, right? They had good beer, right? Yeah. They had prayer. So this is what we hope to do. This is what we think, you know, there's a lot of people of goodwill doing this as well.
Yeah. And that's, and I love that you say that about that they have good beer, because it's not just you're not just making a joke there, that this is a wholesome human right. endeavor. Wherever the Catholic Church goes,
that's right.
It's for the whole person.
That's right.
It's not for just the holy parts of us. I mean, absolutely. I guess that's a weird way to say it.
No, but you're right. Yeah. This is what Joseph Pieper is saying when the remedy is the soul. He references this. He's referencing the goodness of the body, right? That there are things like I said, pleasure, good beer, good conversation, friendship. Those are good things, right? Festival, you know, festive things. Joseph Pieper's book, Theory of Festivity, right? Leisure basis of culture. These are things that he was attuned to, and he's writing after World War II in Germany, right? Yeah. He saw all the horrific things that happened in World War II, and he's still calling us back to the goodness of our nature.
And, all right, so now people are going to be curious about Benedictine College. Give us the last word, and where can they find out? I want my kids to go there now.
Absolutely. Okay. We welcome you. Benedictine College, Atchison, Kansas. We have a website, of course, but we encourage a visit. For sure, because being, you know, you can see things on a website, but it's hard to really understand the vibe, the ethos of the place. So come visit, come check us out.
All right. I got to find some way to get to come visit, but to get Chris Check to pay for it, for me to come. Is there?
We're getting you and Chris back there. We're going to have some monastic beer.
Okay. All
bring right. it.
Best kind of beer. Joe is the Dean of Students.
That's
I'm
right.
sorry. I don't
That's
know
right.
why I got crossed up That's there right. for a second. Joe Wirtz is the Dean of Students at Benedictine College. And we're very grateful for you coming in. Thank you for a very
thank
fine
you,
hour.
Thank you, Cy.
And thank you, Megan. Thanks very much for coming in. All right. Jimmy Akin coming up next hour. It's an open forum. Go ahead and call whatever your question. We'll take it. 888-318-7884. Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Jimmy Akin, our guest this hour, and it's open. No, let's call it Ask Me Anything. That's our new thing. We're moving from the open forum terminology to the Ask Me Anything. So if you've got a question for Jimmy, it's an Ask Me Anything hour. You want to know about the faith? You got a question about a mystery? Whatever it is, you can talk to Jimmy about it. 888-318-7884. Jimmy Akin, senior apologist here at Catholic Answers and the proprietor of Jimmy Akin's Mysterious World. And a debater. That's something I never mentioned. Jimmy goes out and does debates with people. Hello, Jimmy Akin.
Hello, Cy Kellett.
So what's going to drop tomorrow?
Well, tomorrow on Mysterious World, we're going to be looking at an UPART. UPART is an acronym for Out of Place Artifact. And there are various artifacts that have been found that seem to display or claimed to display a level of technology that you would not expect given the cultural location they originated from. So tomorrow we're going to be looking at an UPART known as the Baghdad Battery. It was found outside of Baghdad in the 1930s, and people have proposed that, including one of the first guy who did a published analysis of it, so an actual archaeologist, proposed that it's an electric battery, it's a chemical cell, and they may have used it to do electrical things back in the Sassanid Empire around 1800 years ago, which would dramatically predate the development of the modern chemical battery, which was in the 1700s. So we're going to be looking at the Baghdad Battery, and we know the case for it being an actual battery, and also other possible explanations of what it may have been and what it was used for. And the answer I'm going to come to is something that will be really surprising to a lot of folks.
Out of place artifact? Is that what, UPA?
Yeah, yeah. UPART.
UPART. Oh, artifact. Oh, yeah. UPART. Okay, a new term for me. Oh, that's very cool. So that'll drop tomorrow in Jimmy Akin's Mysterious World. You can always find Jimmy Akin's Mysterious World. There are scores and scores and scores of episodes available, more than 300. Just go to mysterious.fm or pick up the phone and call if you just want to ask Jimmy the question, 888-318-7884. Every single line full at the moment, which happens when Jimmy gets here. We're almost 4 minutes into the show. I think before the show even started, we were full. But you can keep dialing because he answers the questions, and that usually frees up the lines. 888-318-7884. John's in Texas watching on YouTube. John, welcome. Go ahead with your question for Jimmy.
Hey, Mr. Akin. My question today is, how would you rebut philosopher James Sturba's new logical argument from evil? So he lays out three moral evil prevention requirements, and then he formulates an argument from them that shows a contradiction. So I'll read you the three requirements, and you can tell me which one you reject and why.
Okay. All right.
One, prevent rather than permit significant and especially horrendous evil consequences of immoral actions without violating anyone's rights as needed when that can easily be done. Two, do not permit significant and especially horrendous evil consequences of immoral actions simply to provide other rational beings with goods they would morally prefer not to have. And three, do not permit rather than prevent significant and especially horrendous evil consequences of immoral actions on would-be victims in order to provide them with goods to which they do not have a right when there are countless morally unobjectionable ways of providing those goods.
Wow.
So the claim is, if I understand correctly, that Sturba is asserting that all three of those would be moral requirements of a good God, and therefore either, given the fact that there are horrendous evils, that that God would not be able to exist, or at least would not be able to be fully good. Is that the argument here?
Yeah, if you accept those three requirements, okay, there's a logical contradiction. And Swinburne, by the way, denies two.
Yeah. So I'm afraid that I'm faced with a couple of difficulties at the moment. One of them is your phone connection isn't the best, and so I didn't hear everything you said. And the other is that all of those are very lengthy, and I've only heard them the one time. And so... I'm not I wasn't able to fully absorb them. And so in order to give a fully professional answer, I would need to be able to take them in text form and look over the different clauses in them carefully. I would say that, and you know, I don't want to make you reread all of them because that would be bad radio. But I think that the existence of evil, including horrendous evil, is tolerable if it is compensated for by an equal or greater good. And therefore, as long as God compensates individuals who have experienced horrendous evil with a greater good, then we don't have an ultimate problem here. A good being can tolerate evils of any magnitude, but they can tolerate evils in order to provide a greater good to someone. And a common example of that I often cite is, you know, there is an evil when you get a child vaccinated. It's going to hurt and it's going to be fearful. And so the child's going to have fear, the child's going to have pain, but those evils, physical evils, are tolerable because of the immunity to even worse diseases that the child is going to get. And in the same way with us, no matter what happens to us in this life, it's going to be a finite evil, but God has in store for us, as St. Paul says in 2 Corinthians, and he also touches on this in Romans, he has an eternal weight of glory prepared for us that will outweigh anything that happens to us in this life. So that would be the core of my answer. Now, if you want to email me at jimmy@catholic.com, maybe not this week or next week, because I've got debates I'm preparing for next week. But if you want to email me at jimmy@catholic.com and give me the three statements where I can read them carefully, I could give you a more focused answer on which one or ones of them I would reject on the basis of what I just said.
Thanks, John. Well, we'll leave it there. And if you want to send those to Jimmy, I'll let you do that. But thank you for the call. As I said, all the phone lines full. We'll go to Denver, Colorado now. Paul is listening on that machine, Alexa. Paul, go ahead with your question for Jimmy.
Thank you, Si.
Sure.
Hi, Jimmy. Jimmy, I think it was a couple years ago, I was inspired by one of your Mysterious World podcasts on intermittent fasting. And I tried that, and I can't help but feeling that my mind is clear. And now that my mind is clear, I think I just got a bullhorn holler from a Holy Spirit that I need to return to the Catholic Church.
And oh, because good.
My heart is like stone hard. Every time I try to go to the church, I freeze. I'm like, I want to go home. I just don't want to be here. When I start a rosary, I just freeze up. And I just don't know how to get over it. I didn't know if you would have any suggestions or maybe some book that I can probably read to melt the stone out of my heart.
Yeah, well, first thing I'd say is I think your heart is softer than you perceive, because if your heart was truly stony, you wouldn't even be thinking along these lines. So I think that this is a sign that God's grace is what Jesus is doing for us by becoming present in the Eucharist, what God does for us in the rest of our lives outside of church. So there are a lot of things you could think about to try to appreciate what's happening at Mass more than otherwise. When it comes to the rosary, you know, that's a common devotion and it speaks to a lot of people, but it's not a universal even in the Catholic Church. There are various Eastern Catholic churches where the rosary is not a tradition they follow. So it's not obligatory that you say the rosary. If you're getting something out of it, and when you say it, that's great. But if you're not getting something out of it, well, you don't have to say it. And if you persist in saying it, you know, despite feelings you might have, well, that can even be meritorious because then you're dealing with it, something spiritual despite a difficulty you're having. And so I would tend to just put feelings to one side and not really worry about them. I also would recommend, now there are a variety of different devotional books that have been published. In fact, there's a lot of devotional books that have been published to inspire people to greater appreciation of God and spiritual activities. Unfortunately, I'm not super familiar with a lot of devotional books because my reading tends to be more academic rather than devotional in nature. But there are a couple that I'd recommend. One of them, which we can send you, is a little short book I wrote called The Words of Eternal Life. And it's a basic defense of the Christian faith and the Catholic understanding of the Christian faith that is meant to be light and easy to read and focuses on the concept of love. And so that's something that might help. Also, one of the great spiritual classics of all time is The Imitation of Christ by Thomas A. Kempis. And loads of people have read that and found it tremendously spiritually beneficial, whether they're Catholic or not. In fact, even other, you know, Protestants will read The Imitation of Christ. And so I'd recommend that. And other than that, I'd also just, you know, check out some devotional works by different authors and see which ones speak to your heart. They may not all, but if you read around in devotional literature, I'm sure you'll find some things that do speak to you.
Paul, I'm going to leave it there because we have to go to the break. Hang on the line and we'll get an address to send you The Words of Eternal Life, True Happiness, and Where to Find It. We'll be right back with more Catholic Answers Live. Ask Me Anything with Jimmy Akin.
Let us help you with your question today on Catholic Answers Live.
Do you have a question but prefer to ask it privately? Catholic Questions can help. Go to CatholicQuestions.com to ask your question online, email us, drop us a letter, or give us a call. Longtime Catholic Answers Live apologist and author Jim Blackburn or another Catholic Questions apologist will be happy to assist you. Catholic Questions proudly supports Catholic Answers Live, so visit us at CatholicQuestions.com today. That's CatholicQuestions.com.
At EWTN Radio, your family. And because you're a part of our family, we value your opinions on what you hear on EWTN. You can call our listener comment line 24/7 at 205-795-5773.
We value your comments, your questions, and any suggestions you may have to make EWTN Radio even better.
205-795-5773. And thank you for listening to EWTN Radio.
Welcome back. Catholic Answers Live. Ask Me Anything. Jimmy Akin, our guest. You're welcome to call. Again, line's quite full, however, today, so you'll have to give it a few tries, maybe. 888-3187-884. Going to Omaha, Nebraska now. Watching on YouTube, Trevor in Omaha. Trevor, welcome. Go ahead with your question.
Hi. Yeah, I was curious how you would go about proving that somebody like Polycarp, for example, was actually taught by an apostle, and when we read his writings, if those writings are actually what that apostle taught.
Well, okay, so what we have, the data we have, is that various early figures did know some of the original apostles. If I recall correctly, Irenaeus of Lyon, who wrote about AD 190, says he met Polycarp, and that Polycarp had known at least one of the apostles and been instructed by the apostle. And so that's the evidence we've got, and we don't have any countervailing evidence. So if you believe in forming your beliefs based on evidence, well, this is early evidence, and we don't have any reason to disbelieve it. And so, and most historians would say, yeah, this is what happened. Polycarp knew at least one of the apostles. He may have known more than one, but this was a tradition that then was preserved in the church and was recorded at an early date. So it's not likely to be a legend. It's likely to be a factual account. In terms of whether Polycarp taught exactly what he heard from the apostle, well, we only have a very limited selection of what Polycarp wrote. Polycarp wrote basically one letter that survives. We also have an account of his martyrdom in which, quotes are attributed to him. And so to the extent his martyrdom is reliable, we've got a little bit more than what he said in the letter. And hypothetically, it would be possible. Now, my memory is that it's John that he's said to have studied under. And hypothetically, it would be possible to go through Polycarp's letter and his martyrdom account and see to what degree what Polycarp says in those corresponds to things we find in the Joannine literature. Having said that, though, one of the things that that the early church was very big on is preserving the teachings of the apostles. And so I would have no doubt that if Polycarp studied under an apostle, which the evidence says he did, that he would have repeated that apostle's teachings on many occasions during his life, because people would know about his history and they'd say, hey, Polycarp, tell us what John told you. You know, they would want to know that. And so whether or not it's recorded in his letter or in his martyrdom account, I have no doubt that he repeated, you know, stories about what he had learned from John on many occasions. And it just in general, the Orthodox stream of early Christians, as represented, for example, by Polycarp and Irenaeus and Ignatius, what they were trying to do was pass on the teachings of the apostles. And also what we find is that their teachings are consistent with what we find in the writings of the apostles as found in the New Testament. So we have several different lines of evidence that suggest that their teachings were consistent with and based upon the teachings of the original apostles.
Okay, Trevor?
Yeah, I'm mainly asking because I'm dealing with a Protestant who basically he cast doubt on these early writers, and he says that they were possibly like infiltrating the early church. And so I'm kind of looking for something that would help me combat that.
Well, what you might want to do is read. So there are a few things. One, we have some tracts at Catholic.com that are about what the early Christians believed that contain quotations from them. And in particular, you may want to look up quotations about the bishops and about tradition by Irenaeus of Lyon. That's the guy I mentioned. He wrote about 189. So he's, you know, just 100 years from the time of the apostles. And he was dealing with actual infiltrators into the church who were spreading false teachings. Today, scholars refer to them as the Gnostics. And so his defense against the Gnostics was to say, look, we have all of these bishops who were appointed by the apostles and they appointed their successors, and they've been passing down the teachings of the apostles in the Orthodox Christian tradition. And historically, nobody doubts that. Now, as I sometimes say, you can lead a horse to water, but you can't make him think. Sometimes people just won't accept what the historical evidence says, but scholars do not doubt that the Orthodox Christian tradition was passing down ideas that came from the apostles. And if you want to read an early defense of this transmission of information from the early apostles, well, we've got that tradition in the New Testament, which was passed down through the same people that were passing down apostolic teaching orally alongside scripture, as illustrated by Irenaeus of Lyon. So I would check out Irenaeus of Lyon. He wrote a 5-volume work called Against All Heresies, or it's sometimes just called Against Heresies. It's kind of lengthy to read, but there are key passages in it where he discusses the bishops who the apostles appointed and their successors and how they've conveyed the Christian faith down to his day accurately. And he even mentions Polycarp in particular. So if I were going to interact with your Protestant friend, that's where I would go in order to, I would look up Polycarp and bishops and tradition in Irenaeus of Lyon and show your friend what early Christians like him were saying around the year 189. And if your friend, now whoever wants to convince somebody else to change their mind has the burden of proof. So if he wants you to change your mind and say that Polycarp was some kind of heretical infiltrator, I'd say, then show me the evidence. What evidence do you have of that? Because the evidence I've got shows that he was an Orthodox Christian and was accepted as such.
Thanks, Trevor. I'm going to keep moving because we have full lines, but thank you for the question. Let's go to Alan in Jacksonville, Florida. Alan, thank you for the call. Go ahead with the question.
All right. Hello, Mr. Akin, Mr. Kellett. Thanks for having me again. Last time I said I fell in love with Jimmy's glorious beard. This time, that salt and pepper stubble, man.
I appreciate it.
All right.
go ahead. I assume right, you came with that, with more than that, however. You probably have a question.
Yes, I do. Now, speaking of love, I just got married. And now watching dating shows similar to The Bachelor, as I believe, Cy, you have some experience with. Now, my question is, are the methods of dating shown on these shows, albeit beefed up for TV, i.e. playing a field, inherently sinful? If so, is a wholesome Catholic bachelor show possible? So, like, instead of giving roses, maybe giving rosaries.
All right, Alan, thank you.
Okay, I know I just answered a version of this question very recently. It may be in one of the videos from Catholic Answers Live that I put on my YouTube channel, so you could check that out. But I know I just recently answered this question. And the answer is that that it's in principle, they're not doing anything. It's not, playing the field is not wrong. And you know, getting to know different people and seeing who might be a good match for marriage is in principle a good thing to do. And, you know, yeah, you could do a Catholic show where they give rosaries instead of roses, but there's nothing wrong with giving roses. So I wouldn't see, you know, that as a necessity. Basically, the modern concept of romantic marriage is not essential to marriage. In fact, arranged marriages kept the human race going for, well, basically all of its history until the last few hundred years. This idea of a romantic marriage is something that's actually very new. And it's not necessarily the best arrangement, because a lot of romantic marriages, if it's based on romance, well, you're going to go through times, because our feelings vary over time. You're going to go through times where you're not feeling particularly romantic. You may even be temporarily under stress or annoyed with each other. And if you think of your marriage as based on romance, that's going to undermine the basis of your marriage, at least in your own mind. And so in a lot of cultures, the idea is you find a good candidate, or your parents find a good candidate for you, you get married, and you learn to love each other and work together over time. And there's nothing wrong with that. So there's not a single model for how to get married, and shows like The Bachelor, you know, I have hesitations about such shows. I've never really watched them. And I have a lot of suspicions about how this could be, how they could be executed very badly. But in principle, there's no mandated mechanism for how to find a good marriage partner. And if someone went on a show and found a good marriage partner, well, then they could marry them. What you would not want to have happen is forcing them to pick somebody and then putting pressure on them to marry that person if they're not really a good match.
Alan, thanks very much. Thank you for the question. It's Ask Me Anything with Jimmy Akin this hour. It seemed like there's a lot of young people today, Catholic young people, are wishing someone would do something to help them to play the field, like where they could meet one another. Mm-hmm. There's not as many social events as there used to be. They like go to a dance or so. I don't know. Do they have dances anymore?
Yeah.
We used to have a thing called dances that you would go to.
Sometimes, but you know, you got to put down the video game and go to a dance if you're going to meet people in person. Although they do meet each other over the chat channels and games these days.
Yep. Yep. Alan, thank you very much. There's a lot of folks on the line. Lots of questions for Jimmy Akin. You can give it a try. Lines do open up from time to time. 888-318-7884. Right back with more of your questions for Jimmy Akin on Catholic Answers Live. When the resurrected Jesus appeared to disciples on the road to Emmaus, they didn't recognize him until the breaking of the bread. The same is true today. In the Holy Eucharist, we really meet Jesus. In The Eucharist is Really Jesus, author Joe Heschmeyer explains how knowing Jesus in the Eucharist is the key to understanding all of Christian faith. Order your copy of The Eucharist is Really Jesus today at shop.catholic.com or get it at a good Catholic bookstore.
Our Lord needs articulate defenders of the truth to spread the joy of the Catholic faith. Catholic Answers Monthly Giving Club, Society 315, helps you fulfill the call in 1 Peter 3:15 to always be prepared to make a defense for the hope that is in you. For as little as $10 a month, you'll help Catholics grow in faith, bring lapsed Catholics home, and lead non-Catholics to the truth. Go to casociety315.com and join today.
As we read the Gospels, every Christian faces the question again and again, what does Jesus mean? Getting the answer right is critical to both growth in holiness and fruitful evangelization. Want to know Jesus better so you can introduce him to your friends? Then it's time to get serious about understanding his words. Why not join Catholic Answers for our 10th annual Apologetics Conference? Learn from me the parables, sermons, and conversations of Jesus Christ. September 26th through 29th, right here in sunny San Diego. Learn from our guests, Dr. Scott Hahn and Kimberly Hahn, Dr. Ray Guarendi, Father Sebastian Walsh, Billy Junker, Father Paul Check, and, of course, all of your favorite Catholic Answers apologists. It'll be 4 days of fun, faith, fellowship, and a live radio show. Seats are still available, but going fast, visit CatholicAnswersConference.com or call 1-888-291-8000 today.
A beacon is a light, and we'll shine it on God's Word. I'm Deacon Harold Burke Sivers, and I invite you to join me tomorrow for Beacon of Truth on most of these EWTN stations. Now back to Catholic Answers Live with Cy Kellett.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. It's Ask Me Anything with Jimmy Akin. That's what we've renamed Open Forum. I don't know if you knew that, Thomas. Did we tell you that we renamed it to Ask Me Anything?
I found that out earlier. I was talking to Edgar about it. Yeah. I feel like it's a good change.
I feel like it's a good change, too. But we're not getting rid of the TikTok segment. We'll
Certainly
continue
not.
With the TikTok segment.
Certainly not.
Thomas, the TikTok engine here with a question from TikTok. Go ahead, Thomas.
Thank you, Cy. I do think that's a good idea to keep that on Ask Me Anything because TikTok certainly falls under the realm of anything.
Yes, right? That's true.
Yeah.
Excellent point, Thomas.
Thank you. Jimmy, this question from our TikTok comments, someone wants to know, was Jesus' death really a sacrifice if he knew he was going to come back from the dead?
Okay. Sacrifice can be understood in more than one sense. In one sense, a sacrifice is something that you offer to God, and Jesus definitely offered his life to God in atonement for our sins, and so is definitely a sacrifice in that sense. But sacrifice also can mean giving up something that you would otherwise have. And if Jesus had not gone to the cross, then he would have had continued good health and freedom from pain and stuff like that, but he gave it up. He went to the cross, and they drove nails into his hands and his feet, and they scourged him, and they did all kinds of painful things to him. So he gave up the pleasant experience he could have otherwise had by willingly accepting, because he says, no man takes my life from me, I'm laying it down willingly. He willingly accepted extreme pain and physical death. That was a sacrifice too. He gave up the pleasant experiences he could have otherwise had in order to do that. So I would say it's a sacrifice in both of those senses.
All right. Thanks, Jimmy.
All right, Thomas. Well, thank you very much. I thought there might be a little more to your response. Well, I got mesmerized by the two of you.
Last time I brought up a follow-up question to a guest, he called me a heretic. Not you, Jimmy. It was a different guest. So, you know, I'm just backing off now.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I see a little bit of trauma from being called a heretic. I get it.
Yeah. Thomas the traumatized.
Thomas engine. The traumatized tank engine. Sorry about that.
No, it's all good.
All right, off we go to Denver. Thank you, Thomas. Tyler's in Denver watching on YouTube. Tyler, thank you very much for the call. Go ahead with your question for Jimmy.
Yeah, thanks for having me. So in Matthew 27, I believe it's verse 52 through 53, it talks about the tombs being opened and many bodies of the saints that were fallen asleep raised, and they came out and went to the holy city and appeared to many. I was just hoping, Jimmy, could you just shed some light on that?
Well, that's what Matthew says. And so if you think the Gospels are divinely inspired and reliable, then we need to take that seriously. Back when I debated Bart Ehrman, he brought this up. And he said, do you, you know, really think that this happened? And I said, well, you know, Jesus himself rose from the dead, and Jesus raised Jairus's daughter, and Jesus raised the son of the widow of Nain, and Jesus raised Lazarus. So that shows us if God wants to, he can raise people. And Matthew said he did on this occasion, so I don't see any problem with it. And Bart Ehrman said, oh, okay.
So Tyler, is that acceptable? I'm not exactly sure what the objection would be.
Oh, no, I don't have any objection to it. Okay. I was just curious because I didn't see it in the other Gospels. I was like, I don't know, was there more of an event to it? Or I mean, because there's just more information on it. I was curious.
Okay. There's not more information on it, not that's historically reliable. The different evangelists have to make choices about which events they're going to include because they need to keep their gospels down to the length of a single scroll, and so they have to make choices. And well, Matthew made the choice to include this, but the others didn't make the choice to include this, and so that's about all that can be said about it, because we don't really have any discussions of this either elsewhere in the New Testament or in early Christian literature, at least until centuries afterwards, at which point it's too late to be considered reliable. And most of the people who do comment on it just says, here's what Matthew reports, and they don't really provide additional details.
Okay, Tyler.
Oh, all right. Thank you.
All right. Thank you. Thanks very much. I'll tell you what, Tyler, it's a biblical question. If you'd like, I'd love to give you a copy of Jimmy Akin's book, The Bible is a Catholic Book. All you got to do is hang on and Edgar will send it off to you. Just give him a minute. He'll get your information and we'll send you a copy of that book. Thank you very much, Tyler, for the call. Going to go to New Mexico now. Daniel is in New Mexico watching on YouTube. Welcome, Daniel. Go ahead with your question.
Hey, yeah, so I really enjoyed the show, and good job, all you guys. I watch all the time.
Thank you.
My question was, you're welcome. I'm part of a Christian book club, and recently we were reading Jurassic Park, and a big controversy, not controversy, like a friendly discussion, was whether if we could resurrect dinosaurs, right, like they do in Jurassic Park, or resurrect's not the right word, but if we could reintroduce dinosaurs, and there wasn't a big risk of like an ecological disaster, we've minimized those risks, would it be a good thing to do, or should we still just leave them extinct?
Well, dinosaurs are cool, and so I'd love to have some of them back in a safe way, but it's really that risk. You know, whenever you introduce an organism into an environment that is not its own, you're taking an environmental risk. And like here in the South, we have kudzu, which is a decorative vine from Japan. Well, it turns out when they introduced kudzu into the American South, it loved the American South, and it started growing like crazy. And now there are places where the kudzu has taken over and driven out the native plants that would normally be here. For example, between my hometown of Fayetteville, Arkansas, and a nearby town of Siloam Springs, when I drive to Siloam Springs, I go through this patch that where the forest has just been completely taken over by kudzu. And so you're always taking an environmental risk when you introduce new organisms. Now, if you could reintroduce dinosaurs without an environmental or human risk, because that obviously happens in the Jurassic Park series, humans are put at risk in that. And if it could be done in a way that didn't harm the dinosaurs, because you need to think about their welfare too. Well, then, in principle, it would be okay to bring them back. However, showing that it's really going to be safe, both for the dinosaurs and for other organisms and for humans, is going to be hard. There's also another consideration, which is the economic cost of bringing them back. Because if we did bring dinosaurs back, someone's got to pay for that. And there's a question of, is this really the best use of the money to bring dinosaurs back, or could we use that money in some better way to address either human suffering in the present day or to address environmental concerns in the present day? Is bringing back dinosaurs really the best use of this money? And that's something that people could debate. Because you could say, hey, if we bring back dinosaurs, then we can put them in parks and we can bring in visitors, and that'll generate economic activity and that'll generate money for more projects. So, we don't have to look at this as a zero-sum game, but that's an issue that would need to be debated.
I'm just curious, Daniel, did Jimmy come down on your side or are you on the opposite of what you came down in the discussion?
So most of the club was saying no, God made them go extinct for a reason. I was like, no, dinosaurs are cool. If we could prudently minimize risks, then we should do it because they're cool, and cool is good.
Well, the good news is we actually do have dinosaurs around still, because that's what birds are. Birds are a branch of the dinosaur family. They are dinosaurs. They fit the physical description of what a dinosaur is. So we've got birds, and at least the birds that we have now aren't very dangerous to humans. So we actually have dinosaurs safely today. We don't need to bring them back. In fact, you could go out tonight and have a dinosaur dinner if you want. I hear it tastes like chicken.
Have a delicious dinosaur dinner, Daniel. And hang on the line. I'd love to send you, because dinosaurs are cool, I would like to send you one of Jimmy's books. And whichever one you want, just tell Edgar which of Jimmy's books published by Catholic Answers Press that you would like. And we will, if we've got it in stock, we'll send it out to you. I think I better take a break. We'll take a quick break. We'll be right back with more Ask Me Anything with Jimmy Akin on Catholic Answers Live.
Hang on. Catholic Answers Live will return in a moment.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects homebuyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
One of the biggest mistakes a Christian can make is to try to do good without God's help. Saint Therese said, when we trust only ourselves and not God, our soul becomes incapable of virtue. Her remedy? Works of charity. And the greatest work of charity is to share the gospel. At St. Paul Street Evangelization, a Catholic nonprofit, we encourage you to share the gospel with someone who doesn't know Jesus. Catholic Answers is supported in part by St. Paul Street Evangelization. StreetEvangelization.com.
The most original and exclusive Catholic content is on EWTN Radio.
I don't like looking back. I prefer to look forward and keep moving forward. There's plenty to cover. I do a lot of research and try to dig out the bits and pieces of a life or of an agenda that people don't want to talk about.
The World Over with Raymond Arroyo. Tonight, 8 Eastern, on EWTN Radio and Television.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Jimmy Akin, our guest, Ask him anything. It's an Ask Me Anything episode, 888-318-7884, the number. I want to read a question from Tony in Boston. Tony dropped actually just moments ago, but I wanted to give you the question anyways. Tony was watching on YouTube and asked this, Jimmy. Do you ever smoke your pipe during prayer? If so, would this make your pipe a sacramental?
Okay, so there's two questions there. The first one, do I ever smoke my pipe during prayer? And it would be more accurate to say I sometimes pray while smoking a pipe, because I pray spontaneously throughout the day. Mm-hmm. And so I may be smoking a pipe and decide to pray at that moment. What I don't do is set out like for a dedicated prayer time. I tend not to smoke when I'm dedicating time to prayer. But if I just spontaneously pray, well, the two can coincide. The second question, would this make my pipe a sacramental? Well, not unless I intend it to. It's like if you pray while you're eating a meal, you know, let's say you're eating pizza, you put a bite of pizza in your mouth and you decide to pray while you're chewing the pizza, it doesn't make the pizza a sacramental. And so merely two things coinciding, you know, one of them being prayer and one of them being something else, doesn't confer the status of a sacramental on the thing that coincides with prayer. Not by itself. There would have to be intention to use the coinciding thing in a sacred way. So could that happen with pipe smoking? Well, okay, here's where it gets interesting, because in the tradition of many Native American cultures, smoking a pipe is a sacramental. It's done as a form of prayer. And that's understandable, because what tobacco is incense. Tobacco is simply a form of incense. It's a substance that is burned for pleasure. And a pipe is essentially a censer. And so consequently, just like you can use a censer and put incense in it and burn the incense in it in church, you can, and many Native Americans did, use tobacco as incense and pipes as censers, and they did it as a form of prayer. And this is true not only of Native Americans outside of a Christian context, but also of Native Americans who were Christian. In fact, Native Americans who were Catholics. When the Jesuits began to evangelize the Lakota people, you know, one of the things that they had to do was figure out which traditions of Lakota origin were compatible with Christianity and which weren't. And they didn't have a problem with Lakota Native Americans smoking pipes as a form of prayer. In fact, there's even a famous picture of one of the early Jesuit missionaries sitting next to one of the, his name is Red something. I forget it exactly. It may be Red Cloud. But they're sitting together, and the Jesuit missionary has his European-style pipe, and the Lakota elder has his Native American-style pipe, and they didn't have a problem with this. Currently, there is a servant of God named Nicholas Black Elk, who his cause for canonization has been put up by the Diocese of Rapid City, South Dakota. And I did a couple of episodes about Black Elk on Mysterious World. They're episodes 266 and 267. If you want to look them up, you can go to mysterious.fm/266 and mysterious.fm/267. And I talk about how he blended his Lakota tradition with his Catholic faith. And I even have a clip of the Bishop of Rapid City saying, yeah, he prayed to God with his rosary, and he prayed to God with his pipe. And so you could use tobacco is a form of incense, which represents prayer in scripture. You could give that a sacramental dimension, but you'd have to do it intentionally, as opposed to just smoking for pleasure and happening to pray at the same time.
I'm sorry that we somehow got disconnected, Tony, but thank you for the call and for the question. Let's go to Michael in Cincinnati, Ohio, listening on Sacred Heart Radio. Michael, go ahead with your question for Jimmy.
Good evening, brothers. Peace be with you.
and with your spirit.
Thank you. I'll try to be brief. Before Mass this past weekend, I was approached by a couple of parishioners who had a question, and they think I had an answer, silly people, because I've had some studies, formal studies. And as I indicated, it's John 19:25-27, read during Easter, and I said to myself, self, I mustn't have been paying attention on Easter Sunday. But standing by the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas. And they said to me, we didn't know Mary had a brother or sister. So I said, no problem, I'll get an answer for you. So I immediately went home and grabbed my John Sacre Pagina and started scouring through it. And to my consternation, there's no answer.
Jimmy. I'm not sure what the question is.
The question is, did Mary have siblings?
Okay.
Yeah, sure. John 19:25 says she did. It says she had a sister because it says that standing near the cross of Jesus were his mother, so that's the Virgin Mary, and the sister of his mother. Now, the question then becomes, do we know anything else about this sister? And some people have thought that we do, because what John gives a string of several women, and there's a debate among biblical interpreters about how many women are mentioned in this passage. We have a clear, because what he says is his mother, the sister of his mother, Mary the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene were all standing near the cross. So some people have wanted to say that's three women, that Mary is one woman, and the sister of the Virgin Mary is one woman, his mother, and then the sister of his mother is the same woman as Mary, the wife of Clopas, and then Mary Magdalene is the third woman. So that's one way that this passage has been interpreted. It's referring to three women, and when John says the sister of his mother, he then identifies who the sister is by saying she's Mary, the wife of Clopas. Okay. That's one way of interpreting this passage, but I think it's a bad way, because it would mean that in the single nuclear family of the Virgin Mary, there would be two women both named Mary, and that's very unlikely. People tend not to give their children the same name. I mean, I know on Newhart, they had, hi, my name is Larry. This is my brother, Daryl. This is my other brother, Daryl.
Yeah.
But that's a very rare and weird situation, because you give your kids different names so you can call them individually and get them to respond individually. And you defeat the purpose of, you defeat that goal if you give them all the same name, or you give more than one of them the same name. It's going to cause confusion. So it's extremely rare for parents to name two children the same thing. And so I think that the much more sensible way of reading this passage is to say it's referring to four women. One of them is his mother, the Virgin Mary. The second is the sister of his mother, whose name we are not told. The third is Mary, the wife of Clopas. And the fourth is Mary Magdalene. So this passage can be understood different ways, but I think that's the best way of understanding it. But that's just my opinion.
Thank you very much for the call and for the question. I'm going to keep moving. As always, we're full with questions with Jimmy's here. Let's go to Omaha, Nebraska. John's in Omaha, Nebraska, listening on Spirit Catholic Radio. John, go ahead with your question. Hi, John. I'll tell you what, I'll come back to you, John. I have a feeling there's a mute button involved in that situation, but we'll find out when we come back to you. Peter's in Maryland, watching on YouTube. Peter, awful glad to have you. Go ahead with your question for Jimmy.
Hi, Jimmy. Thank you so much for taking my call. The question I had was, I wanted to know, what was the status of adoption of lay ministries and acolytes and lectors in the United States to act as ordinary Eucharistic ministers? I know that back in 2021, Pope Francis had had increased accessibility of these ministries. I just wanted to know if there was. I hadn't really heard anything since then.
Okay, so acolytes and lectors are both lay ministers. They're not ordained ministers. And acolytes are automatically ordinary ministers of Holy Communion. They're not extraordinary. It's actually part of the job description. Lectors, I'm not familiar with making lectors anything other than extraordinary ministers. In terms of adoption, well, they're both authorized for use in the United States right now. They're not particular. Lectors are common. You see those in almost every parish. In fact, basically, you see them in every parish. Acolytes are not as common. Well, I should say, instituted lectors are not as common. Every parish has people serving as kind of deputy lectors that do the scripture readings. They aren't always formally instituted as lectors, though. That is less common, but it's perfectly permitted. Acolytes also are permitted, but their function tends to be performed in most parishes by stand-in sort of deputized acolytes or people performing the function of an acolyte. And that's what altar servers are, altar boys and altar girls. They're basically functioning as non-instituted acolytes. But it is possible to become an instituted acolyte. You just don't see it that much, but I've seen it. You know, there's a parish in San Diego I used to go to where I'd see, okay, here's an adult guy. He's functioning as an acolyte. He's an instituted acolyte. He's not just an altar boy or an altar girl. And that does exist, and it's a ministry that's an option. But because we have kind of deputy lectors and deputy acolytes, there's not a lot of attention paid to these offices in the United States. But if someone's interested in becoming an instituted lector or an instituted acolyte, all they got to do is ask about it and, you know, talk to their pastor and see if it would be a good thing to introduce that ministry into a particular parish. And that's something that could be explored.
Thank you, Peter. I'm moving just to get everybody on if I can. Bill's in Virginia listening to EWTN on Channel 130, Sirius XM satellite radio.
I think we're going to go to John.
John, we're going back to you. I apologize. Hang on, Bill. If we can, we'll get to you. Let's go to John. John, go ahead with your question.
Yes, good evening, Jimmy. The apostles were given the ability to do works and heal. Do we have any idea if that was just through their natural life, and was it extended to anybody other than the original disciples?
Well, we know that gifts of healing were extended to other people besides the disciples in the first century because St. Paul talks about it. If you read 1 Corinthians 12, he gives a list of spiritual gifts, and healings is one of them. So this was a gift that was given to other people besides the original 12, and it wasn't associated with a particular office in the church. It was what's known as a charismatic gift, meaning a gift that God just chooses to give to someone, even though it's not a gift of office. So we know that other people had this gift in the first century, and it's been passed down through history. In addition, even ordinary priests have something of this gift because they're able to perform the anointing of the sick. It doesn't guarantee that the person is going to be healed, but it is a healing ministry that's possessed by every bishop and priest. So you have both the office-related gift of healing that manifests through the anointing of the sick, and you have the charismatic gift of healing that manifests apart from any office. It's just something God gives someone. And both of those have been perpetuated down through Christian history.
John, thank you very much. We'll leave it there, and that will have to be the very last question of today, because it's time to go. It's all come to an end. Jimmy Akin's Mysterious World, however, has a new episode tomorrow, and it's about Oopharts. Did I get it right? Oopharts.
Yeah, the Baghdad Battery specifically, and Oopart.
The Baghdad Battery. It sounds like a sports team, kind of. Yeah. Hey, we're the Baghdad Battery. All right, but that does it for us. Jimmy, safe travels. I know you're going to be heading out to do some debates, so safe travels. We'll see you when we see you again.
Thank you.
All right, thank you. And that'll do it for us. I'll invite you again. Come on the cruise. We do have some spots available on the cruise. Just go to CatholicAnswersCruise.com. We're leaving June 29th from Montreal. We're ending up July 6th in Boston. You can find all about it at CatholicAnswersCruise.com. See you tomorrow, God willing, right here on Catholic Answers Live.